Enough of the bad. We're done talking about the bad. We want to tie a bow on 2020. Let's finish here. Let's talk about a few good things that came out of 2020. Because in the middle of all that chaos, in the middle of all the craziness, there was a silver lining. There were several silver linings. There were some innovations that came about that, hey, maybe we could normalize. Maybe we could take this into the future in 2021. I want to share a few of them with you. The first one, hand sanitizer. It's everywhere now. For a germaphobe like me, what a sight. I love it. Some of y'all didn't know what hand sanitizer was before 2020. Welcome. Welcome to the real world. This is awesome. It's everywhere now. Let's keep that going. Let's keep hand sanitizer going. Curbside pickup. How about that? Only a few organizations really had this going before 2020, but now you don't really have to go inside any buildings. Everybody will bring things out to your car. What a beautiful thing. Let's carry that on. Normalize curbside pickup. Respect and admiration for teachers, for law enforcement, for healthcare workers, all public servants. Awesome. Look, apology. If you're watching and you're one of these people, we've been taking you for granted. I'm so sorry. We finally learned just how valuable you are. We thank you. And let's take that into 2021 and beyond. Thank you to these people who finally got recognition. Let's normalize that. And then finally, look, this is not for me. This is for you introverts, all right? Some of you are so thankful for the extinction of hugs and handshakes. Look, you had your year. Maybe it'll carry on. That's yet to be seen. But I tell you what, I'm looking forward to giving you a hug and a handshake here soon when I can. But we'll see if that sticks around in 2021. My favorite silver lining of all these is actually not anything here. My favorite one is for the very first time in my life and probably in your life, for the very first time, you got a different answer to this question. Have you been? Have you been? How are you? Something we say all the time. For the very first time, we got a different answer. Because what is it always? It's good. I'm good. I'm fine. Or this one, busy. Just so busy. I'm just so busy. But for the first time ever that I can remember, people would admit that they're bored, that not a lot was going on, that they weren't busy. And it was refreshing. They did it guilt-free, and I loved it. Let's normalize that and bring that to 2021. Hey, how are you? Not a lot going on. In the year 2016, all I said was I'm busy. It was probably so annoying. I apologize if I knew you in 2016. 5 years ago was personally my busiest year. In 2016, I was working as an organizational psychologist in Cincinnati. I was doing training and development full-time in the business world. I would do that during the day. And then at night, I'd go to seminary, Cincinnati Christian University, also full-time. I used some work vacation days to take off so I could go to class and get more credit there, constantly reading papers, homework. I was a big brother to a little boy named Rashad through Big Brothers Big Sisters program, so I'd pick him up one night a week. We would do something fun. On top of all that, and really before all that, 2 years into marriage, so just still figuring that out, brand new daughter came into the world in 2016. My wife worked full-time, 12-hour night shifts at the hospital. So I went from never holding a baby, never changing a baby in my life, to suddenly being the sole caretaker for this new baby girl from 7 p.m. to 7 a.m. a few days a week. What did that look like? Well, check out this photo. 2016 captured in one image. There's no soul left in that guy's eyes. I know. I was busy. I was busy, and I was not myself, just so busy. And if it sounds like I'm bragging, well, you must be American. You must be, because it's a very American thing to wear our busyness like a badge of honor, isn't it? Have you been? Have you been? If you'd asked me that in 2016, I'd be one of those annoying people. I'm just so busy. So busy. We're proud of that. We're proud of that. And I think I was proud of that in 2016, how busy I was. But look at that photo. That was not a happy person. I was worn out. I was spent. I mean, my tank was empty. I was barely making it in 2016. But right in the middle of the most trying season of my life, God also gave me the greatest opportunity of my life, the one opportunity that unequivocally changed the course of my life and my family's life in the midst of all that busyness, my first job in ministry. Echo Church in the Walnut Hills neighborhood of Cincinnati gave me a chance. So I woke up early that first Sunday morning. This was the day I was going to be introduced to this new congregation as their new pastor. Terrifying. I was nervous as can be that morning, and I was dead tired. How tired? I stopped and got coffee on the way to church. If you know me, you're like, hold on, I've never seen David drink coffee. You're right. Yeah, I don't drink coffee, but on this day, I drank coffee, and I brought that cup of coffee into the church with me, into Echo Church. I sat in the very back so I could take it all in, so I could see how they did things and get a feel for the place. Echo has service in this beautiful old Gothic-style church, massive vaulted ceilings, stained glass windows all down the sides. And the pews were elevated so they would rise as they go back. Wasn't a bad seat in the house. Well, during the first worship song in my very first few minutes at Echo Church, about to be introduced as their new pastor, I'm fidgety. I'm nervous. I'm running on empty as a human being who's just too busy. And in my exhausted state, you wouldn't believe what happened. You probably would. I kicked over my coffee. I set my cup of coffee down. It was basically full because not a coffee drinker. So I kick it in my fidgetiness, and 14 ounces of hot coffee just roll down the floor, just roll all the way down the church. I am mortified as I'm watching people that I've never met in the middle of worship just stare down at their feet. Their feet are getting wet. Row after row begin to notice as the wave of coffee goes down. The worship team can sense something. I know they can tell people are moving strangely as they're singing these songs. This mysterious brown hot liquid is rolling down the church. Oh my goodness, are they going to stop the song? I'm going to melt into the ground. Lord, this might have been a mistake. Make me disappear right now. Someone runs to the back to get paper towels. I don't know where they are. I've been in church for 10 minutes. I have no idea. It's my first day. The song finally ends, and I can hear shoes squeaking on the floor. It sounds like a high school basketball game. Shoes soaked in coffee that I didn't even drink. Is this the worst first impression you've ever heard of? It has to be. They introduced me as the new minister and the one who spilled the coffee on everybody, and so I went home and did only what I could think to do. Put my house up for sale, and now I'm Victory's problem. Now I'm your problem. So thank you for having me. Spilling something is not out of the ordinary for me. I've done it many times in my life. But I know why it happened in such a fantastically disastrous and dreadful, traumatizing fashion on this day. I know why. It was a clear signal to me. I was beat. I was overworked. I was spent. I needed rest. I want to welcome you to our fourth and final sermon in the series entitled Breathing Room. For 4 weeks, we've been slowing down. We've discussed the dangers of a go, go, go lifestyle and the importance of creating margin in our lives so that we can truly connect with God and live life where we experience His peace. Our definition that we've been going with for breathing room is this. Breathing room is the space between our current pace and our limits. The space between our current pace and our limits. So we all have a certain capacity. How much capacity you have? And breathing room is how close you're coming to that. This is the space, this is the margin that you have, is called your breathing room. And if you don't create an adequate amount of breathing room in your life, you're going to burn out. You're going to feel disconnected, and you will eventually crash. Last week, Josh talked about creating margin in your finances. That may have been an uncomfortable one for you, depending on where you are with it. But I believe we'll talk today about something even more controversial, even more countercultural, more upside down even than we do our finances. And here's my thesis statement for this morning. There is no such thing as work-life balance. There's no such thing as work-life balance. The term work-life balance was popularized in the 1980s. The 80s were really the first time that Americans started to consider the distribution of work-life and home-life, work and rest, really for two major reasons. There was this cultural and political movement during the Reagan presidency where people were chasing the American dream, economic stability, individualism, hard work, big ideas in that time. And more than ever up to that time, women were jumping into the workforce and feeling this pressure of earning a living and then taking care of the house. The second reason work-life balance came on the scene is technology. The 80s were the first time in human history where communication technology was such that men and women began to be more accessible at home. Email and cell phones really didn't explode until the 90s, but the 80s was where it began. And suddenly the lines between work and home, work and rest, become blurry. Thus, the term work-life balance. And we know what people mean when they say this, but my argument here, and I believe the biblical argument here, is that there is no such thing as balancing work and life. You cannot balance work and play. You cannot balance work and rest. The scales just never seem to even out. Think about it. If you're constantly taking work calls around your house, is that balanced? Is that balanced? Your work gets 50% of your attention, and your family gets maybe 50% of the rest of your attention? That's just silly. Another thing about balance is, what's the goal of balancing? Stability. equilibrium, just not toppling over, just staying afloat. That's the goal of balance. Do we really want, is that all we want from life, just to not topple over? There is no such thing as work-life balance. Instead, we work from rest. We operate work-life balances, or is displayed on a pendulum. So it looks like this. Over here we have rest, and over here we have work. Not a balance, but a rhythm on a pendulum. God designed us to rest and to work, to rest and to work. We go back and forth, committed to one and then committed to the other. It's not a balance, it's a rhythm. It's a rhythm. And here's the first point I want you to see about this work-rest rhythm. We work from rest. We work from a place of rest. And we see this in Genesis. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day, the creation account. God made mankind on the sixth day, and you know what their first full day was? It was a day of rest. It was a day of rest. The Jewish culture actually reflected this. It's this timing of day was described in Genesis as night and then day. Night and then day. Jews actually begin their day at sundown. So the first thing they did was rest in the goodness of God and then swing back from a place of rest to a place of work. Rest and then work. God worked 6 days and then he rested. God didn't rest because he needed it. God's not like us. God didn't rest because he was tired. He rested. God rested on that seventh day so we could build this rhythm into our lives. It's a gift. He did it as a gift to you and me. The Gregorian calendar, the one we use, the one so much of the world uses, it's actually derived from the Hebrew calendar. And the first day of the week is what? Sunday. Today. Today. We're here in a place of rest. We begin with rest. We work from a place of rest. But most of us don't do this. We go, go, go until we feel exhausted, and then we take a vacation to recover. And that's why you need a vacation from your vacation, right? God designed you to work from rest. So the pendulum begins here and swings over here. But you and I know that that's not really how we've done it. We've chosen not to operate this way. Many of us, we swing our pendulums all the way to work. We redline, we go all out, or we think we do. We exhaust all of our energy, all of our resources. And then what happens? We free fall into rest, and it's truly not restful. What would your life look like if you actually worked from a place of rest? This work from rest is not just wired in us, but we see it in nature. Think about it. God created the seasons. Right now, where most of us are watching, maybe not you folks in South Florida, sorry, I feel so sorry for you. We have seasons here. But in this season, there's a time of rest in the landscape. Trees have dropped their leaves. Farm fields are inactive. Nothing's in bloom. Nature's at rest. It's charging up because in a couple months, the sun peeks through. The flowers, the leaves, the insects reappear. The crops grow. And suddenly, we're at a place of work again. Our actions begin to bear fruit again because we work from a place of rest. And because God wired us this way, this pattern is seen in almost all that we do too as humans made in his image. TV shows, sports, fashion, food, the things we eat, art, we see seasons on all this stuff. Things go dormant for a time, they pause, they charge up, they rejuvenate, and they reappear. They're refreshed. This is a ubiquitous rhythm in human life. We work from rest. Well, then why is rest so scary sometimes? Why do you and I not want to be caught dead saying that, hey, we're in a time of rest, not too busy? Why? Why do we fear that? Well, because of pressure from other people, but also for this big reason. We love progress. All people, we just love progress. We love doing. We love making things happen. We love achievement and accomplishment. Some folks have personalities that are driven by this, but to some degree, it is a core need for all of us, regardless of personality, to be better, to do better than we did yesterday. However we define it for ourselves, we all love progress. But let me let you in on a little secret about progress. Research tells us, we know from experience, and we see it in Scripture, that the way to progress, the way to maximum productivity, maximum growth as a person, the way to progress and growth in our relationship with God is by establishing a healthy rhythm of rest and then work. Rest and then work. That is how we get true progress. In John's gospel, he records one of Jesus' famous teachings. John says, or Jesus says, as recorded in John, I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, those who reject God, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes. This is what's important here. He prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. Even more fruitful. You see that? You want to take more ground in your life? You want growth and progress in your work? Or more importantly, in your faith? Well, what we're seeing in Scripture and in life and in research is that the best way to do that is to do something called prune. Prune. So we remove things. We take things out. We swing away from a place of work. We pull our pendulum back to rest. And what we're doing is we're removing, we're taking away, we're saying no to some things now so that later, we can say yes to others, to more important things, the things that really, really bear fruit. That's called pruning. And for those who are united with Christ, you can see we have rhythms of fruitfulness and rhythms of rest. Following Jesus means some things will fall away. And we will have loss. We will miss out on things. We will say no to things. And in that process, God is refining us so that soon, we can swing back into a place of growth. We prune and then we grow. A place of rest into a place of work. Gardeners and florists know that they've got to cut rose bushes down to almost nothing so that they can really bloom like never before. To grow your budget, what do you have to do? You have to stop spending so much. You have to prune. Grapevines are cut back 2 years so their root systems can be established. Only then can they handle this huge, abundant weight of this crop of grapes. Prune and then growth. Even Jesus' disciples, some of the giants of the early church, the Apostle Paul, so many of them, they went through this period of just abiding in God, just cutting out all distractions, cutting out everything that wasn't absolutely necessary, a period of rest with him, in a state of just building up the tools they needed in order to soon be empowered and equipped to go out into the world, to do life-changing ministry, to work. And if you at home are chasing after progress, and I think we all are in some way, if you're chasing after progress, I hope that your marching orders are crystal clear here. I hope it is. Because pruning is a prerequisite for progress. I want you to know that. Pruning is a prereq for progress. What did Jesus do so often before and after he would swing his pendulum all the way to work? And when Jesus worked, he really worked. Teaching massive crowds, traveling all over, healing the sick. Jesus brought more progress to the world than it had ever and will ever see. Think about that. He did. Most progressive ever. And yet, in the time between, Jesus was so often found where? Alone, praying, pruning himself from all the activity, resting, abiding in the Father before he swung to work. Pruning is a prereq for progress. So please don't be fooled into believing that the path to progress is this insatiable work. That's not it. We do our best when we work from rest. How about that rhyme? We do our best when we work from rest. So how serious is God about all this? How serious is God about rest? Well, a couple weeks ago in my men's group, the study we're doing asked us to go back to Exodus to look at the Ten Commandments that God gave Moses. So we're doing this to ourselves. The study told us to count how many of those ten that we've never broken or that we've kept up to this point in our lives. It was an interesting activity. And I think I speak for all the men in our group that night when I say that there was one major thing that stuck out to us, and it was right there in the middle of the Ten Commandments, one that we often overlook. Says, remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God, and on it you shall not do any work. In other words, rest. Set aside time to stop all your work, just dwell with God. Allow him to pour into you and to equip you for the work that's ahead. Do you see this? Rest is a commandment. Did you forget about that one too, maybe, or neglect it? Or you thought it was just like the 9 commandments and a really good idea? No, God put rest in the same category as do not kill someone. Hey, don't worship any other gods. Don't covet your neighbor's wife. But also, I command you to rest. It is a must. And God is teaching us that rest is a requirement. When God made mankind on the 6th day, need for rest wasn't a design flaw. Neither was work a design flaw. These were gifts. Both of them, gifts that God gave us to teach us something. We have immense, irrevocable purpose. The fields are ripe, but apart from abiding in God, apart from creating rest, from creating breathing room, we just don't receive all his goodness, and we can truly do nothing apart from this. 2016 was a great year for me, but I tried to do too many things. I thought progress was there if only I worked harder, devoted more hours to these things, and you know what? I didn't do any of them really well. None of them got even close to the amount of me that they deserved. I didn't truly do right by any of them. My secular job, my ministry, seminary, volunteering, being a good husband and a dad, none of them got a fair shake. Why? I was trying to balance. I was trying to balance rather than create rhythm. I had it all wrong. I was your weird uncle at a wedding. No rhythm, trying too hard. I didn't have it. There was trying to balance and no rhythm. And it felt like, if this feels like a slow down talk, it is, it's slow down. That's the series we're in. But let me throw in one sentence for the other contingent, because some of y'all have been camping out here. We've been resting. 2020 has brought that. And if that's you, I pray that you launch out of that place, that you get to work at your job, here at Victory, in your local church, in your community. Maybe 2020 was a season of rest for you. I'm telling you, friend, time to giddy up. Let's launch into work mode now. But the predominant message, I hope we all see through this series, I hope we all see this, is that maybe we have to rethink rest. Maybe we've got rest all wrong. Because rest is not a punishment, it's a gift. Rest is not a suggestion. No, it's a requirement. Rhythmic rest is not a decelerator. In fact, it's a prerequisite for progress. We've got to work. We have to work. But first, God calls us to abide in him, to rest, to have these rhythms. As we invite the worship team back up here, I want you to consider this with me. What's really important in your life? I mean, really, what is the most important thing in your life? Because whatever you're doing right now, you're the only one that God put there to do it. No one else in the world can do it quite like you can. I'm not talking about your role as manager. They're going to replace you. They're going to find a new one. I don't mean your position at the firm. They're going to find somebody else to do that too. This isn't about your clients, your company, your stakeholders. You'll be gone someday, and they'll replace you. That's true for all of us. All of our organizations are going to be just fine without us. We're all way, way more easily replaced than we think. It's your people I'm talking about, your family, blood and chosen family, the post that God puts you in. That's what truly matters. That's what you're here to really do. So I want you to remember, don't trade what's unique to you for something somebody else will do. Don't ever trade what is unique to you, this post that God puts you in, this circle of people that God puts you in, this community that God puts you in. Don't ever trade that for something that somebody else is going to come do after your time is up. If the Lord God allows you to live into advanced age, or for anyone who can see the finish line approaching, man, I just hope that when you look back on your life, you're at peace with how you spent your time, how you spent your resources. I hope if you get to the end of your days and you have a moment to reflect, I hope you're pleased with your choices to rest and to work, with how you prioritize things. Because time is our most valuable currency. By far, money cannot touch it. You know this. And where does your time really matter? At home. Your spouse, your kids, nieces, nephews, your best friends, your grandkids. I doubt if you come to the end of the road, we will ever wish that we spent more time on our computer, more time at our desk, more time on our phones. That's not going to happen. And if you get a chance to someday look back at your life and the person next to you asks you that question, how have you been? How are you, my friend? How have you been? How is life? How have you been? Not a single one of us, none of us, are going to be proud to say, I was busy. I was so busy. I had a lot going on. I just kept busy in my life. No. Breathing room is the space between our current pace and our limits. And I pray that you create some more breathing room in this lifetime while you still can. I hope and I pray that you make room. Make room. Let's sing the song together.
This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down. Every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender.
Matthew's gospel, Jesus says, "Come to me, all who are weary, all who are burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me, for I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your souls." God made us human beings, not human doings. Our greatest need at our core, our greatest aspiration, our greatest longing is not anything we can do. It's not anything we can do. It's about who we can be with. It's about just being with God, dwelling with Him. This is our greatest longing. This is our remedy for the emptiness we feel sometimes, just to be with God. This series, Breathing Room, what is breathing? Breathing is about life. We know something's alive when it's breathing. God is inviting us to take a deep breath, to live life fully, to breathe in deeply, to live life how He designed. And our purpose is to be with Him, not about what we are doing. We're going to be deceived. We know we're going to be challenged. We know that the enemy is trying to deceive us into thinking that all these other things matter, but they're futile. They're futile, God. That is not what you have for us. Let's pray together. God, you're the good shepherd. When we are tempted to go astray, when we're tempted to be consumed, to be so bought into, to prioritizing things that don't truly matter, God, we're asking you to pull us back, to reach us before we're lost, to show us, Lord, that you have so much more for us here, that our worth and our value is not tied up in our work, but it cannot be taken because of who you are, because of who you've made us, Lord. Shake up the ground we walk on. Break up our futile habits. Busy is a liar. Busy is a fraud. It is fake, Lord. Call us into what you're doing. Help us to make room. Your way is better. Your way is better.
Have a great week.
We want to thank you all for tuning in with us today. If this message or any part of the service helped you in any way, please consider partnering with us financially to live out our vision of connecting people back to God. If you're on Facebook, you can help us continue to reach others by sharing this video to your page or by tagging someone's name in the comments. If you're watching on YouTube, the website, or the app, consider sharing the link with someone you know who needs to hear this message. If you need more information on what your next step may be, any information about Victory, or someone to pray with you, you can text NEXT to 317-576-2288, and someone from our Next Steps team will get back with you as soon as they can. Again, if today was your first time attending a Victory service, be sure to fill out that connection card or reach out to someone in the chat so that we can connect with you. Make sure you stay connected with us on our social media pages on Facebook and Instagram and on YouTube as well. A few reminders here before we go. Next Sunday, January 31st, we are reopening the building. If you'd like to join us in person for one of our adult or middle school gatherings at 9 or 10:30, you'll be able to do that then. Just a reminder that we will only have kids programming during the 10:30 service, so please plan accordingly. Masks will be required during our 9 o'clock service, and they will be highly encouraged but not required during our 10:30 service. Of course, if you aren't comfortable coming back yet, we get it, and we would encourage you to continue joining us online. We love having you here. Also, we're kicking off a brand new series called Fight Club next Sunday. This series is going to tackle all the misconceptions of what masculinity is in our culture and set up our families and our church to win. You are not going to want to miss it. Invite a friend to come and see. And remember, here at Victory, we don't just go to church. We are the church. Have a great week, and we'll look forward to seeing you next Sunday here in person or online.